Labor Day special edition of The Morning Routine. I thought, let's keep the winning streak alive and talk about Labor Day. Labor Day, a much needed day off, a 3-day weekend capping off the end of another great summer. Barbecues, boating, camping, parades, such a good time. Although this year it might be a little bit different, but that's okay. We're still gonna enjoy the day. But how do we get here? Where did Labor Day come from? Why do we even have a Labor Day? Let's talk about it. I mean, did we just decide to give ourselves another holiday, another excuse to not go to work that day? One more 3-day weekend at the end of summer to get one more, squeeze one more vacation in? What are we doing? How did we get here? Nope, not even close. Signed into federal law in 1894, not because it was the nice thing to do, but instead it was actually done in response to end a crippling boycott and strike of a major railroad company. In 1894, railroads were still the main way to ship stuff and move about the country. Cars hadn't been around that long. They were very small, and they weren't really for long distance travel. It was horse and buggy still, besides the railroad. So not having major aspects of the railroad organization throughout the country working was causing havoc throughout the entire country. Now, why were the workers striking and boycotting? Bad working conditions, overworked, all that kind of stuff. But it didn't start with this movement. Let's go back a little bit, a little back in the past with Carl. In the 1800s, at the height of the Industrial Revolution, pretty much everybody worked 12-hour days, 7 days a week. 12-hour days every single day of the week. And in most states, kids ages 5 and 6 years old were able to go to work in mills and factories and in mines. The crappy part about that was, not that you're working at 5 and 6 years old, but you were paid a mere tiny, tiny fraction of what the adults were getting paid for sometimes more dangerous work. So again, Labor Day didn't spring up because of one event. It was a culmination of many events. During some of the early and mid 1800s, organized events, a lot through unions, started popping up all over the place throughout the country, disputing the labor conditions in many cases and the wages in many conditions. So it was happening in little pockets throughout the country already, just kind of perkling up a little bit. For example, in 1882, 12 years prior to the federal law of Labor Day being signed in, 10,000 people marched in New York City from City Hall to Union Square to stand up and advocate for themselves about the horrible working conditions that many people were having to deal with at the time. Many others were going on as well, mostly peaceful, but one in 1886, the Haymarket Riot, was an organized event that turned very, very violent, where many police officers and workers who were demonstrating were killed. Now, the railroad strike that I talked about was called the Pullman Strike. And Pullman was a car company. They made railroad cars, and they worked on railroad cars. And the event started because of the bad working conditions. They wanted better working conditions and better wages for the more dangerous types of jobs. Now, the Pullman strike became the straw that broke the camel's back in 1894, not just because it was one more event, but it was a very expensive event. When you break down commerce throughout the entire country, that starts to cost a lot of people a lot of money. So when it started costing that much money to have one major event going on, the government decided to step in. They needed the tax revenue. But there was many lawmakers that were for this in advance. It wasn't just about the tax revenue. The economic side of not having freight and commerce moving throughout the country, that was a very big deal. That needed to be rectified. So this was the straw that broke the camel's back. But in 1894, during the same time, there were several other major events going on almost at the same time, mostly peaceful, but very large. And that, my friends, is how Labor Day came to be. Labor Day is a day for us to take a break from doing such hard work and really the way I like to look at it is Labor Day is not just about taking a day off to go on a vacation. Yes, many of us are going to do that. And we're going to relax. We're going to kick back. We're going to do fun things. But it's also a time to reflect on the hard work that you do. And that everybody, even though your jobs, our jobs, may be frustrating and challenging at times, the labor that we do supports so many different things in our economy that makes our lives here, especially in America, very, very amazing. So on this day, just take a moment, be thankful, be grateful, be appreciative of what's around us and what we can do and what you can do.
Good morning, everybody. It is Labor Day. Day of no program, but it is a national day. It is National Labor Day. It's kind of a holiday. People like to do things. So how apropos that it is national, and there goes the dogs. It is National Beer Lovers Day. And one of my favorite things, salami. Can't go wrong. Labor Day, beer, salami. What more could I want?
I got the beer and the salami. Yes.
So you guys have a great day today. Rest up on National Labor Day, Beer Lovers Day, and salami.
So have a great rest of your weekend, and we will see you tomorrow where we can work on more ways to get out there and get those jobs and get into the economy. All right, guys, have a great day. Thank you so much for hanging in there. Hope you all had a great weekend. For the morning routine, this is Monday, and we're out of here. We'll see you tomorrow on Tuesday. Bye.